Before the weekends, it's time to answer the questions you sent to us via email, Twitter, and Facebook. I'm Edric Mendoza. This is On the Money. Here to answer your money questions is registered financial planner Jesi Bondoc. And since it's Q&A day, the On the Money team is complete. We have Salve Duplito and Melissa Hecolea. Hello, ladies. Jesi.
Hey,
hi,
back
Eric.
On our Q&A Friday.
Yeah, I'm
welcome
so glad.
Back.
Hello.
I am so glad to be back and raring to answer questions. Let's go.
I know we missed you.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I missed you guys.
Good, I'm glad to hear that. Anyway, the first question is from Elpidio Durante, who is based in Saudi Arabia. He emailed us a couple of questions. What is an investment portfolio? What is a mutual fund? Should a bank close or file for bankruptcy, who will pay me back the money I invested in the mutual fund? And how does inflation affect my money in the bank?
Those are
that's a lot of questions.
It's not a question.
He maximized his question.
I'm
sorry, that was what, four?
Mr. LPJ is very efficient in his email.
Yes.
So better answer the first question. What is an investment for portfolio? Mm-hmm. Well, in the simplest term, remember how models have this huge, like an album or
yes.
a portfolio where
of
they
pictures,
yep, pictures of different dresses,
different poses and outfits.
Okay, in an investment industry, yeah, an investment environment, you have the same. It's like a piece of paper where you include all your investments. They could be your cash in bank. They could be your investment in stocks, in bonds, in government securities. So it's just a template showing you how diversified or what are the investment instruments that you currently have.
Okay.
There.
It's like your bag of investments,
exactly.
And there are different stuff inside. And this is what I love about On the Money. People are asking more intelligent questions about investing and saving, because now people realize that it's not just one thing that you put your money in. It should be a collection of different investment items,
right.
So you can diversify
and you're protected.
Spread your risks, exactly.
I think that's the most prudent way of investing your money. You have to diversify your funds. Don't put all your eggs
in one basket.
Because this is the thing that I know people ask all the time. Where can I put my money? And they're just thinking of one. So it's like everything is in one instrument. And when that instrument goes down, hello portfolio. You're
goodbye.
Gone.
Goodbye,
exactly.
Portfolio.
That's not hello.
Not hello portfolio.
Yeah, yeah.
Bye-bye portfolio.
That's right. So he asked what a mutual fund is. Can you explain that to him?
Sure. A mutual fund is one type of an investment instrument where you pooled funds to be invested on a particular purpose. Mutual fund have different types. Major types are, number one, equities or stocks. Everything is being invested on the stock market. Second, we have bonds. These are government securities or debt from corporate or private companies. And third is a balanced fund or a hybrid fund. It's a combination of both.
Okay, yeah. So that's good. The balanced fund, the hybrid fund then is already a slightly diversified.
It's slightly diversified, yep. But remember, when you invest, you always have to go back to your investment goal. So each of these asset classes, equities, bonds, and balance, serve your own purpose.
Right.
Okay. He also asks how inflation affects the money, his money in the bank.
Okay, I get a lot of these questions all the time. I think Filipino's favorite word right now in finance is inflation. So
it's a favorite word.
Yep. Inflation is the rise of goods and services. So if you have, let's say, a regular savings account in one of your favorite commercial banks giving you 1% per year, and the average inflation right now in our country is around 3-4% nowadays. So given, let's say, 4% inflation rate, you're being given 1%. So technically you are negative 3% in returns. So it diminishes the purchasing power of your money. So
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Simply put, if you have 100 pesos next year, it will be minus 4%.
4%, exactly.
Oh. Your 100 pesos will buy this much burger.
Yeah.
Next year, it's going to be
a less.
Yeah.
No more bread. Just the bun.
No more
and also,
no more.
So much for that.
No more meat.
The bun. Okay. we've harped on that in many different episodes, right?
Okay, anyway, we have another question from Alex who emailed us. He says, I'm 40 years old and earn 100,000 pesos a month. What's the best investment for me?
Okay, that's a good question. So number one, Alex, what I suggest, what I advise is you have to identify first your investment goal. Okay? Why are you investing? Mm-hmm. What's the reason for investing? Is it to buy your house, dream house? Is it to buy a car? Or is it to fund your retirement account? So establishing a clear, a defined investment goal, okay, is very important, it's very vital. Because it would give you the reason, or it would give you, it would tell you how long can you commit on that investment, okay, the time horizon. Secondly, it would give you, or it would tell you the level of risk that you can take, willing to take, and ultimately find an investment vehicle that would suit the need that you have right now, that financial need. So it's very important, know your financial goal first, okay? Let's say if your goal is to establish an emergency fund, so you're better off investing in bank products like savings account, time deposit, SDA, where you can take out your money anytime you want. Now, if your goal is to build your nest egg for your retirement, then I would suggest you take more aggressive investment instruments like stocks, mutual fund, or even UITF.
Okay. And how much of that 100,000 do you think he should be putting aside every month?
I think that's what's missing in this question.
Yeah, exactly.
How much is this expensive monthly?
Exactly. So you have to identify.
He can't invest all his 100,000.
100,000 is the income.
Where's his gas money? His
right. Yeah, it's not really advisable. We do not advocate that you spend all your money in investment. Remember, if you're investing for the future.
Right.
Okay. The risk there is, what if that future will not happen? Okay. Mm-hmm. You're sacrificing your today. So it should be a balance of your today and of your future. So the best thing that you can do, Alex, is you have to compute first your expenses on a monthly basis, your necessities, also if you have some bills. Any excess from there, compute it from your other needs, allocate it from your other needs, but you have to make sure you have to allocate something for your investment.
Yeah, and also make sure that you already have
emergency
a buffer fund before you invest.
Fund, I was going to say.
Yes.
Exactly. Okay, we have another question, and this one comes from Lily. She says, I'm 55 years old and a housewife. I placed $3,000 in a time deposit. It earns 1% every 6 months.
Tiny.
Yeah, tiny. Exchange rate at that time I opened my time deposit account was 56 to the dollar.
Wow.
To fight inflation, will it be better if I withdraw my placement and buy mutual funds, bonds, or stocks instead? If so, how many percent should I allocate for each asset class?
Lily has lost around 20% in
exchange
rate. So horrible.
Exactly. So the answer there, Miss Lily? Yeah, it's a solid yes, okay? Withdraw your fund, okay? With a 3! Yes. Okay, you are losing money because of the inflation rate. Okay, your bank is giving you 1% or 2% annually because it's 1% per 6 months. Now again, the average inflation rate that we have, let's say it's 4%, then you're losing 2% of your money. So you're better off withdrawing your funds and invest it in an investment instrument that could yield better than 4%. There.
Guys, do you realize there's around I think a trillion pesos in
time
banks,
exactly.
Time deposits.
They're so popular here. Why are they so popular?
Right. Filipinos are not used to just risking their money.
Yeah.
They want access to it all the time because they're so scared.
If anything happens.
So even if they're losing on it, they'd rather just have it there.
Yes.
Yeah. That's quite bad.
It's quite bad. So that's why I love this show, okay? We educate people about this stuff. So it's very important, Lily.
Now we love you too.
Thank you. Okay. We have some mutual fund companies and UITF, trust departments from banks. You can approach them and ask them for bond or even stock investment in dollars, averaging between 7 to 10% return every year.
Mm-hmm. We're going to have more questions in a bit, guys. But more of your questions will happen after this break. Stay with us. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On the Money's Q&A Friday. Still with us to answer your money questions, our registered financial planner, Jesi Bondoc, and the ladies. Let's get going with the other questions.
Yes. Okay, we have this question from Joy. After watching your show, my husband and I are now seriously considering putting the savings of our children, ages 9, 15, and 16, in mutual funds. Is it wiser to invest in three different trust for accounts? And should we specify the years which they can have it?
At first, I thought that Joy was my wife. I'm like, but no, the ages are not my soul. Okay, don't worry.
Well, maybe she's disguised them.
Yeah.
Good for Joy, huh?
So good for you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I was like, you gotta ask me.
Okay, to answer Joy's question, yes. If your goal is to give your children a head start in investment and savings, yes, I would say that it is best for you to open three IDF accounts or interest for accounts.
Interest for.
Yep, for your children. Mm-hmm. Now, for the question on can you designate a particular year? Normally, the mutual fund companies with ITF would give you two options. The first option is the fund will be automatically be transferred to your beneficiary or your child upon reaching the age of 18. Okay, the second option is it can be transferred to them upon reaching the age of 18, provided you give a written consent.
Safer.
Segurista. A 12-year-old kid cannot open a mutual fund account?
They can, interest for, but interest it will be transferred under their name upon reaching the age of 18, legal age.
Jesi, what's the benefit of that rather than just pooling it all in one account?
Well, number one, confusion. And secondly, you want to teach your children about saving and investment.
So especially that age, no?
Yes.
Ownership. Yeah. They know it's theirs. Yeah. It's fun to do it. They can save more money and add it to their own account.
And I know some parents who are doing this kind of investment proposal and teaching for their children. What they do is they open accounts for each. Then they encourage their children to save up from their allowances. So if they reach the amount of 1,000 from their savings, it will be invested again mutual fund account.
Perfect.
Then at the end of the year, whoever performs well, gets a reward.
Wow, they make it a contest.
I like that.
I like that.
What I wanted to ask is, do they have access to online parang so they can see how their funds are doing, because it provides positive reinforcement.
So they can stop
spending their cash gifts. Christmas is coming and cash gifts are coming in. If they see that it's moving, maybe they can put more money in.
Yeah, thanks to technology, we have online access to all investments, especially mutual funds, even UITF, where you can check every day the performances.
And can even move from one fund to the other, right?
Yes, like that.
You can, huh? You can transfer from one fund online.
I think that's the power of compounding. Mm-hmm. This is the only way that you can compound your money in investment in mutual fund is through switching from one fund to the other.
Really?
Okay.
Yes, let's say you got this 5,000 investment and you earn 10%.
Yeah.
So you want to safe keep the 10% already and you want to compound it. So transfer it, let's say you're invested originally on equities, transfer it to bonds first or money market. Then transfer it again. So you got your capital. Instead of 5,000, it's already 5,500.
I see.
I suggest also to Joy to start with a small account, like in a bank first. A small account, and then when it goes, maybe put a cap on it. Maybe it's when it gets to 15,000, and then move that to a mutual fund account.
Right.
So they can see that there are ways to do it that's with order. It's orderly.
They see the path also.
They can feel it more now. Wow, I'm an investor.
Right.
Exactly. You know what everyone does
from a piggy bank to a more sophisticated.
So maybe start. Edward, that's a great idea.
I will.
Start with a piggy bank because it's very visual, and then move to an ATM account and then mutual fund.
Yeah, I think that's the most important thing that parents should realize. Mm-hmm. So Joy here is trying to help out his children to give a head start in their investment and saving. But I think she should follow through with a proper education guidance. Follow through with the education with your children.
My kid started to ask about mutual fund when he was five.
Really?
Wow. You're kidding.
Well, that's because his mom is selling it.
Right.
No, it's because his sister was investing.
Oh, really?
How old was
and he was
sister?
Asking, what's a mutual fund? So that's where the carpool thing came.
That's great. How old was his sister when she started investing?
She was 10.
Good.
Yeah. I like that. We also got that idea from Rose, another guest, right? You can give financial instruments as a gift, like a stock, etc. I'm going to do that with my kids and
this
homeschool
Christmas,
them
take a
in
photo,
that way.
Okay?
Yeah, I will.
Get a stock certificate.
I will. Definitely.
Exactly. Okay, we have another question from DM Castino. He sent this via Twitter. He asks, I want to invest my son's savings in the stock market. Mm. Is it difficult to do so? So I suppose, what does it entail, investing?
Well,
so
step by step, technically speaking, it's not difficult. You just call your broker, buy a single stock, a company.
Fill in the forms,
then wait for your stock to go up, then withdraw the funds. Technically speaking, it's easy. But
it's only that easy, though.
Yep. But getting returns, huge returns or rewards from your investment, that's a total different story. So.
Okay.
DM, remember the three E's in investment in the stock market. Number one, you should have education. Second E is expertise. Third is excess cash. Okay, if you're not educated enough for you to start investing in the stock market, especially it's your son's savings, so you better study first. Okay?
Where to put.
Secondly, expertise. Expertise and experience goes hand in hand. Okay, so if you're not quite familiar with the industry or with the market, so you better, again, prepare yourself first. Third, is it excess cash or is this son saving earmarked already for a particular purpose in the future, like his education? So I won't advise you use them as an investment for in the stock market. But if your purpose is to teach your son to invest in the stock market, then I think, I don't know how much is the savings, but some online brokers, you can open an account, you can start investing in the stock market as low as 25,000. Mm-hmm. So I think that is relatively cheap in terms of education or educating your child in the stock market.
Well said.
You know, mine is a departure from what you're saying.
Sure.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Okay.
All right. You finally said it. That's
let's
good.
Let's assume that this is excess cash, there's an emergency, there's a buffer fund somewhere, et cetera, et cetera. I think that every kid should have a stock.
Yes.
You know,
yeah.
It takes a long time to grow your money in the stock market. And if you start when he's 1 year old, 1 year old, he has all the time in the world.
It's like planting seeds.
I mean, yeah, it's like planting seeds.
That's right. Grow,
you know
when
the market's going
yeah?
down. Yeah, you can play around with it. Maybe use that in preparation for his college fund.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
I think every kid in the Philippines should invest.
Look
should have at least one or two
stock
certificates.
So when it's my kid's birthday, okay?
Yes.
I mean, you guys want to tell you?
Bye.
I would agree, yeah. If you go to more developed countries, most kids there know about mutual funds, stocks, and we are here left alone. Just knowing that's the savings and the piggy bank that we have. So I think it's a good move as early as from inception, okay? As early as 1 year old, okay, you put some money, invest it in the stock, let them grow over time.
Yeah, very good, very awesome.
But remember, you have to teach them, okay? You have to
yeah, that's
along
part of
the way,
education.
Okay? You have to educate them about it, okay?
Right.
Good thing there are online stockbrokers.
Yeah,
that makes it much easier.
So you can see. It's really important for these kids to see that it's actually working for them, right?
Yes.
People are visual, so they need
to see. They learn from the ups and downs.
Exactly. Okay, we have another question from Roman Rena. He sent us a message via Facebook. He wants to know if it's good to invest in government securities. And he also wants to know what other investment funds he should consider.
Okay, again, same with those two questions before. You have to go back with your investment objective. What is your objective?
Okay. I like the way you do that.
That makes it very clear, right?
Yeah, no,
exactly. Emphasize the basics.
People
need to be very specific when
they send their questions in.
You have to know your investment objective, okay? This would be your roadmap. This would guide you, okay? This would give you the purpose of why you're doing the investment. Government security are domestic fixed debt. And they say these are safer than other debt instruments because they are backed by sovereign guarantee, unless the Republic of the Philippines goes bankrupt and files for bankruptcy, then your investment in the GS or government security funds are okay.
Let's knock on wood.
God forbid.
Okay, that's not mimic those countries in the Eurozone.
Oh my gosh, yes.
Yep. So there, it is a good investment if you are conservative. most government securities would yield around 7 to 10% even per year. These are treasury notes. Okay, so if you are conservative and you want higher yield, better yields compared to your bank products, then government security would be a good investment instrument for you. But again, go back to your investment code.
It's a good graduation gift.
How much is a government security?
The retail treasury bonds, you start with 5,000.
Yes. Okay.
And then there are, you can go up to 25, 50. You can already invest in government securities.
And okay, you can go into a brokerage for stocks. If you want to buy that, you go to a bank. Banks would have that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes, even other mutual fund companies would carry a government security fund.
As an option.
Bond
as an option, yep. On bonds. Yeah.
Okay, and any other investment funds you should consider?
Okay, we have a lot. Again, if your goal is to get better returns and fund something that is a huge project, then I think you can go with stocks. Mm-hmm. Aggressive. Remember, higher risk, higher return. So it entails a lot of risk when you invest in the stock market. But ultimately, it would give you a better return compared to other instruments. You can also try bonds if you're more conservative. Mm-hmm. Or if you're at the middle, you can try the balanced one with the combination of equities and bonds.
And maybe for our overseas viewers, they can, you know, you're already in another country like those in Singapore or in Hong Kong, and you have access to more mature financial markets. And I can't understand why people still invest only here.
I agree.
You can diversify across countries. Mm-hmm. I think that
would be best. They offer great products actually overseas. Anyway, send us your money questions via email or through Facebook and Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Thanks, ladies. Jesi, thanks for being here again.
Thanks for having
me. That's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again on Monday for more talk and tips so you're always right on the money. Have a great weekend.